Walk with me.
I'm cut off now.
Step closer. She says, you're not cut off.
My head is.
Is this your video, so you opened up.
This is mine? Okay, awesome. Hey everybody, FX Homo here. I'm here with...
me.
James Yeager in Camden, Tennessee at Tactical Response. Next month in October of 2014, James, I'm taking several of the high-risk civilian contractor classes. Really excited about those. And I've never taken a class like that before. So all the classes I've taken up to this point, I've worn pretty much normal clothes with maybe like a micro rig and a sling thrown on. What do I need for the contractor classes?
Well, as far as like the clothing that you wear, plan on it being ruined. Like, I'm serious. Cuts and tears and at least stained beyond use. You will have a set of training clothes after you finish that class. but they need to, you know, allow freedom of movement. You're going to be getting up and down a lot and stuff like that. If it was something that was a quick drying material for rain and sweat, that would be great, but not necessary. We use pyrotechnics in the class, so flame retardant, cotton, or something like that, you know, as an outer layer is going to keep shit from melting to your skin. As far as, we'll just start at the bottom, footwear, something that covers the ankle, like a military style boot, a hiking boot's okay, but like a military style boot with like a taller, you know, the taller collar that comes up for more support, you're gonna appreciate that. Again, pants with flexibility, you got to have knee pads and elbow pads. And guys are like, yeah, but my knees are fine. Okay, first off, they are for now. Number two, yeah, after you do about 100 up and downs, you'll wish you had knee pads on. And a $30 pair of knee pads will help your $50 pair of pants make it longer.
Okay. Now, pants. You need tactical pants? I'm wearing Blackhawks right now.
Yeah, certainly anything like that will work. I mean, you could do the class in jeans if you wanted to.
Okay.
You know, but as long as they allow freedom of movement. On knee and elbow pads, I just wanted to show these real quick. These are the ones I use and recommend. These are the Alta knee pads, and they are articulate. This particular style of Alta is articulated above and below the knee. So it's like, you know, segmented. And these are the best to stay in place and offer you the most coverage. And so Alta, you can get these on Amazon. You know, whatever, but that's what I recommend for the class.
Now,
And they have to be in multicam.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, don't come in here with any fucking like brown stuff.
Got it. Okay. So you've done some stuff on 511 clothes recently.
Yeah.
My wife has a pair of 511 pants that have knee pad inserts. Uh-huh. Are those good enough, or do you still want the outer ones?
Keep in mind, you're still going to destroy the outer layer of pants with those. But they're better than nothing. But that's not good enough for the class.
Okay. And then a belt.
Uh-huh.
If you have a good gun belt, is that good enough?
Well, it depends on, you know, what kind of rig you're going to wear. Like, you know, some guys do the class as you would if you were actually deploying with full armor and, you know, a duty belt, you know, and stuff like that. But in general, yeah, a good gun belt as a base for whatever rig you're running is going to be the right thing.
Okay, so I like the SOE belt. That's probably what I'm going to use.
Wait a minute. The SOE duty belt or the SOE pants belt, or are you going to run a subload?
I don't know yet.
If you're going to run a drop holster or a subload of any type, you have to run it off a duty belt. So you have to have a pants belt. The duty belt goes over it, and there are these things called belt keepers. These little strips of nylon with button snaps on them, and they go around both belts that hold the belt together. You see them on cops, police duty belts all the time. But a lot of times guys buy the outer belt, the duty belt, and they don't buy those, and so the thing turns sideways and stuff on them. Buy it and put those keepers on there.
So, I think I know what a drop leg holster is.
Yeah, like a tack holster.
I've never actually used one.
Right.
What's a subload?
Anything that you carry below your belt. Like, just generically, it could be a gas mask pouch or a magazine pouch or whatever.
Okay. So, then we mentioned rigs. Is a micro rig enough to cut it, or do you
No.
need...
Okay. We recommend that the students be able to carry 8 magazines.
Okay. And...
and there will never be a drill that we do in the class where you go, I brought too many magazines.
I see. Does it matter AR, AK, or is that a preference thing?
It is a preference thing, but I will be 100% honest with you. If we let's say there's 12 people in class and we start the class with 6 AKs and 6 ARs, typically by the end of class there's 12 AKs.
Okay.
Like we run these guns hard. The environment is unforgiving, and if we were just going to do like one massive drill, the ARs would be fine. But we keep doing that massive drill over and over and over, so you don't have time to clean it between the runs. And eventually, so it's got sand and dirt and, you know, gunk in it that inhibit it from running. So, you know, I got no problem taking an AR-15 into combat. I've done that before. But for a class like this where it's just over and over and over in these, and I tell you, if you've never, unless you've been in the military, like, to anybody watching this, you have not done drills like these. Go look at our contractor, you know, videos that I've got on here, and understand that the stuff that I put on YouTube is the PG rated stuff.
Okay. Got it.
Like, there is stuff that people just shouldn't be seeing without, you know, an explanation of what's going on. But these are the most physically demanding classes that a civilian can take. And as a matter of fact, like, we had a guy, we have people come through all the time from every group you could imagine. We had a Delta Force guy here a few years ago, and he said that he had everything in the military's arsenal to train his men, and we did a better job in a middle of a field in Camden, Tennessee than he ever thought we could. And he has everything at his disposal, and he was impressed with what we did in this little spot in Camden, Tennessee.
Awesome. So now we have some sort of upper body garment that totally covers everything?
You should, yeah.
Okay.
Now, the reason we do the contractor classes are only in April and October. Like, you'll never see one on the schedule for July or August. Why? Because people die. It's just too much. You know, it's too hot. Because you need that protective clothing. You couldn't do multiple runs, if you could imagine, you know, multiple full-scale runs in July. You couldn't do 6 or 8 of those a day.
Okay, so what do you recommend for shirts?
You know, I do like the 511 and Blackhawk style combat shirts that are real thin. I've done some videos on them. They're real thin with the heavy sleeves. You know, they're just great under armor. You know, they're wonderful.
And gloves?
Yeah, so mechanics gloves are the ones I recommend. And if you look at my review of mechanics gloves on my YouTube channel, there's a discount code down there for buying off the mechanics site.
And should we bring a couple pairs just to be safe, or?
Yeah, I mean, like, there's nothing you're gonna bring that I wouldn't tell you to bring two of if you had them. Like, I know it sounds weird, but I have, when I go train, I have two sets of knee pads because my knees hurt all the fucking time. But like, there's nothing that I would call mission critical that I wouldn't bring two of if I had the opportunity.
Mm-hmm. And that includes two rifles and two Glocks if you have them too.
I would have two full loadouts. If I had them, if or whatever I had of two loadouts, I would have.
Okay.
Like, if I'm telling you, sorry to interrupt you, I'm telling you to bring, you know, pack 8 magazines, but if you've got 16 magazines, bring 16 magazines. That kind of thing.
Okay. 16 rifle magazines, let's say, if you can. And then how many pistol magazines? Like, or how many magazine holsters and all that?
It's not a pistol class.
Right. Okay.
I mean, you know, whatever, you know, a couple spare mags is more than enough.
Okay. Do you have anybody that you recommend for plate carriers?
Man, there's a bunch of good stuff available. We just I just made friends with Robert Scott down at Armorwear, and they make the Marine Corps issue plate carrier. And I can loan you one of those if you'd like for class.
Okay.
You know.
Yeah.
Let's try. The Banshee. If you guys watch my reviews, the Banshee from AR-500 Armor, that's a real good rig too, especially for the price. You know, it's not made in America like the Armorwear rig is, and I'm not trying to get into, you know, versus. But if you're on a tight budget, that Banshee is a really good rig for the money.
Okay. And do you wear something around your neck?
Yeah,
too?
Yeah,
okay.
Shamog or some kind of something around you. Like, you should, everything should be covered up. You know,
okay.
You should have a hat on with your ear pro, and like, just imagine hot brass and sparks and flame. Just imagine that, and you need to be protected from that. You know?
Okay. Anything you wear on your around your face, around your head,
just,
or anything like
just,
that?
Just that shemagh.
Okay.
You know, and if certainly if it's cold and you can put some kind of balaclava or something on, that's fine.
Okay. Who do you recommend for, like, eye protection?
I mean, there's a ton of good things out there, but I'm an Oakley guy, and, like, people are like, man, but Oakley's cost $150. Like, what are your eyes worth? Oakley's, make sure you get the shooting glasses that are ANSI rated, and but Oakley's have the best optical quality of any off-the-rack glasses. Like, and what I mean by that is I've had people before that they were, like, trying to sight their rifle in, and you get cheap safety glasses, and it's magnified in different spots and different ways and around the lens, and I just change glasses with them. Put my glasses on them, wear their glasses while they shoot, and then their group goes boop, just like that. You just, it's hard to go wrong with Oakley's.
Now, in a class like this, there's going to be a lot of environments and situations that you're put in. Like, do you go with sunglasses, or do you go with clear glasses, or do you go with both?
Well, when I actually worked in Iraq, I took both with me. And or if I was had my Oakley's, I had two sets of lenses. You can just pop them out, change them real quick if space was an issue. You will be fortunate enough to know when you're going to do your night mission. So you'll have ample time to change the eyewear.
Okay.
But you do need both clear and you have to have clear for the class. You don't have to have tinted, but you do have to have clear eye pro for the class.
Okay. Maybe this is off topic, but those yellow lenses, do you ever use those for anything?
No.
You know what I'm talking about, right?
I'm not a colored lens guy.
Okay. Got it. Obviously, we have ear protection on, and I know you've recommended the Peltor Sportax. Those work really well.
Yep.
Now, on our head, what are we wearing for a hat?
That one looks good.
Could you wear a ball cap and not like a, I've seen some of the brimmed hats in some of the videos.
No, they don't work well with ear pro.
Right.
Or you got to fold them up where you look like you're Australian or something. So don't do that.
Okay.
Nothing against Australians. I actually like Australians. I hate the English.
Okay. We didn't talk about elbow pads.
Yeah, I did.
Did we talk? Is it the same company as the knee pads?
Yeah, I showed you an elbow pad.
Oh, that's an elbow pad?
Yeah, it's for your elbow.
Sorry.
Booyah, so, right
there.
Is
that the same as the knee pad then?
No, the knee pad's bigger. Let me see. I don't know. I got them some more. I didn't know I was going to be judged. Okay, I'm sorry. These... knee pads and elbow pads.
Okay. Same, both Alta.
Yeah, okay. Both Alta. Amazon.com. You're in like Flynn.
Okay. Very cool. Are we forgetting anything else? What about gear? I mean, you...
Your rifle, make sure you have everything for your rifle. Like if you put a scope mount on it, it came with a little scope wrench, bring that thing, because it's going to come loose. Make sure all your shit's Loctited, your sights and all that stuff, make sure it's Loctited. And to put Loctite on, make sure you degrease the threads on both receptacles or the Loctite will not work. A bunch of gun cleaning. You're going to clean your rifles constantly. So you whip out the mega cleaning kit, and people show up with these little bitty fold up cleaning kits. Nah, like, you're gonna need real shit.
Like what?
Like good brushes, you know, okay. The big brushes and, you know, and all that stuff, like for magazines, because magazines get dirty. A baby bottle brush, believe it or not. Go to Walmart. Here's what's funny. If you buy the baby bottle brushes in the baby section of like Walmart, they're like $5. But if you buy them in the dishwashing section, they're $1. It's a different brand. How weird, huh? But a baby brush to clean your magazines out with just some water. Never put lubrication in magazines.
Right. Okay. So we've got our AK or AR in our magazines, our pistol in our magazines. Is a single point bungee sling sufficient?
I'm a single point guy, but a two point convertible sling is great.
Okay. And what else? What about, like, do we need, like, radios or anything like that?
Yeah, you're supposed to have a radio for the class, and because you have to be able to talk within your team. And people try to skate by on the little FRS radios that are, like, $5 or whatever. But for But for $35 to $50, you can get into a Baofeng ham radio that's programmable. And it is 10 steps above the FRS radios. It's not a great radio. If you break it, it's not a big deal. But it's way better than FRS. Way better power, way better listening quality, audio quality, everything.
Okay. We talked a little bit about hydration and things like that. Do we need to have like a hydration carrier of some kind? Or
you don't necessarily, for this class, have to have a hydration carrier. Because if you could imagine, this class is going to be quiet. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's going to be like this, like 5 minutes of fury. And then everybody's sweating. Okay, jam mags. You've emptied every mag you got. You got to go pick your mags up. You say, oh, God, and drink water. Like, you'll have time to drink water. It's never a bad idea to have a Camelback. But for this class, you don't really have to have one. And, like, when I was in Iraq, I took 2 Camelbacks with me, and I never put water in the first one. Because we did so many vehicle-mounted operations, we didn't get out and walk around. I was in a car, so things on my back didn't really work that well. And we drank water so fast that it wouldn't have made sense. Like, they had the big 1.5 liters, and we'd carry those with us.
Okay. Is there anything that you shouldn't bring or you should leave at home, or that people, you know, sometimes bring and then end up taking off?
Oh, whatever? That happens all the time.
Okay.
Like, yeah. And like, I show up with, like, everything on the side plates and front plates and soft armor and a helmet and, you know, and nut plates and, you know, and foot plates, everything. And then by day two, they start peeling out of that stuff. So here's what I'm going to say. Training it. Like, stick it out. You made it through one day. Stick it out. And whatever you think your fighting rig is, bring that rig and fight with it. You know, don't take the plates out. And I'm not trying to be a butthole or anything, but you put that rig together for a reason. And just because it gets tough to do the class, you know, like, if you couldn't physically do the class without taking the plates out, which is the most common thing, if you couldn't physically do the class, then take them out. But if you're just like, the class would be easier if I didn't have them, then leave them in.
Okay. Great. Anything else about the contracting classes that...
There's a bunch of stuff. I mean, we could talk all night, you know, about them. And there certainly are more interesting classes, you know. And, like, you know, for you guys that have, like, maybe taken fighting pistol, that is a 1, and a contractor class is an 11.
Okay.
As far as like, energy and just, like, just sheer... power, you know, it's really hard to express, but it's more of everything you like about tactical response.
So someone's looking at the website and they're like, am I ready to do this? How do they know if they're, like, physically and mentally ready?
That's really hard, because everybody puts 100% into the class. Like, you become a part of this team. You don't let your teammates down. But everybody, and even somebody that is absolutely a physical specimen, everybody wishes they had more. It's because it's for your team. You know, these guys bond. You got a mission. You're doing it, you know, and they don't want to let anybody down. You know, that's why, you know, you see these spec ops unit guys, they train all the time. They, because they don't want to be the guy that holds the team back.
Okay.
And so now, that was a long answer. The short answer is, you need to be able to move around in your gear. You know, I mean, it's just that simple. You need to be able to carry 8 mags in your rifle. And even if you went with the minimum amount of stuff, we're still talking about 20 pounds. You know, if you went absolute minimum, we're still talking 20 pounds, maybe 25 or 30. So here is what I'll tell you. I tell people, if for you guys that don't know what a burpee is, go look that up. But I tell people to get ready for this class, do burpees. I don't run, don't do push-ups, don't go lift weights at the gym, do burpees. A couple of reasons. Number one, that's a pretty fucking hard exercise. It's a really fucking hard exercise in your gear. And that's how I want people to do it. It's in their gear. But the class is, I'm up, he sees me, I'm down. I'm up, he sees me, I'm down. I'm up, he sees me, I'm down. It's kind of like burpees, except you're not jumping when you get up. But there's a whole lot of getting up and getting down in the contractor class. And I don't think you'll mind me just mentioning his name. Scott Guthrie is a guy that does our web stuff. And we had the conversation. I said, do as many as you can. And when he showed up, he said, the most he could get to when he showed up for class, I believe Scott told me 23. It was 20-something, I think, anyway. And that doesn't sound like a lot, but in full gear, that's a lot. And he got through the class. And he'll tell you himself, he wishes he was in better shape, you know. And what I hope for the guys that come through that aren't in great shape is they use this for a catapult, to a motivator to get them to get in shape.
Okay.
And we got, like, Dave Bigger's old ass gets up, works out every single morning, puts on his plate carrier, picks up a 75-pound punching bag and runs with it, you know, and moves. And, you know, Tim Morris is just sits and eats ice cream.
Okay.
So.
If you guys want to learn more about the hybrid civilian contracting classes or any other classes, you can go to tacticalresponse.com. That's where I found the video that we were talking about before for the contracting class too. And anything else you want to say?
No, I'm probably going to see if he'll let me use this video too, because we talked about a lot of really, you know, good stuff that people should know, and a lot of people are just too lazy to go read the course reviews and figure out what worked for people and what didn't. So this is actually a lot better video. It's a lot more in depth than I thought it was going to be, you know. So,
well,
just because you're expert interviewing processes.
Okay.
I mean, like, if I was like gonna like had a product I wanted to sell, I would seriously pay you real cash to pimp that for me.
You hear that, internet?
Because you are awesome.
Thanks, James. Appreciate it. Remember your responsibility to be ready
for... Don't use my lines! Your responsibility to be ready for the fight never ends.